Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the belly of the fish, saying, I called to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. You cast me into the deep, into the heart of the sea, and the flood surrounded me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. Then I said, I am driven away from your sight. How shall I look again upon your holy temple? The waters closed in over me. The deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped around my head at the roots of the mountains. I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought me up. You brought up my life from the pit, O Lord my God. As my life was ebbing away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you in your holy temple. Those who worship vain idols forsake their true loyalty, but I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will pay. Deliverance belongs to the Lord. Then the Lord spoke to the fish, and it spewed Jonah out upon the dry land. See, is God's good word for us, God's beloved people? Thanks be to God. We are continuing Summer of Rock, and I confess that I stretched the definition Summer of Rock because I really want to include Johnny Cash in Summer of Rock. And so we are looking at Johnny Cash and particularly his song, I Walk the Line. Now, in my defense, Johnny Cash is famous for crossing over a huge number of genres, including rock and roll. Against me is that I Walk the Line is definitely in no way a rock and roll song. But Johnny Cash is by far one of the most successful recording artists in history. Prior to his death in 2003, he had sold over 90 million records across many different genres that include country and rock and roll and rockabilly. And at one point, he even covered a heavy metal song. I mean, he did a lot. But he was born in Depression-era Tennessee, grew up in simple surroundings, and never forgot what it was to be a poor country boy. Even when he was a millionaire, he connected with the broken and the downtrodden and the broke and the out of luck, and gave voice to their pain and gave voice to their suffering through his deep voice and his freight train rhythms. Johnny Cash is one of those true American artists that cut across genre, cut across time, and in a deep, powerful, and often simple way, gets to what it is to be a person, what it is to struggle, what it is to be alive. I have my own weird relationship with Johnny Cash. I grew up in the suburbs, North Houston, right? Not naturally a Johnny Cash guy, shall we say. But see, this movie about his life came out, starring Joaquin Phoenix and Reese Witherspoon, came out in 2005 when I was 19 years old, when I happened to be starting to do prison ministry. And so I was doing a lot of, like, carrying sound equipment into prisons. And so I found myself often walking a prison yard wearing a guitar on my back, wearing all black. And I did that on accident the first time, and then I did it on purpose the rest of the time, because Johnny Cash is the man in black and famous for his work in Folsom Prison. Johnny Cash ends up this multi-platinum award-winning guy. He ends up this genre-crossing guy. He ends up this guy that understands his own brokenness and is able to speak to broken people. He even ends up doing work with Billy Graham as an evangelist to reach people who suffered from addiction, reach people who understood how broken they were and viewed himself as the chief among all sinners. That's late stage Johnny Cash. But I Walk the Line is not late stage Johnny Cash. I Walk the Line is early stage Johnny Cash. Johnny Cash is like 24 years old when he writes I Walk the Line. He's only been out of the Air Force for 2 years. This song comes from very early in his career. And actually, it was written not too far from here. It was written backstage at a gig in Gregg County, Texas. And so this is a country song written in Texas. And it is essentially a young man's pledge of fidelity to his spouse. And turns out, makes sense. Johnny Cash was newly married to a woman named Vivian Liberto. They had been together, married for 2 years. He was out on the road, and he was writing this song about how he was going to be faithful to his spouse. And the lyrics themselves are beautiful. I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line. And my favorite verse is the next one. I find it very, very easy to be true. I find myself alone when each day is through. Yes, I'll admit that I'm a fool for you. Because you're mine, I walk the line. Great. And Johnny Cash ends up in a partnership that looks a lot like that. To June Carter Cash. Later in his life, and they end up together for more than 25 years, and when June passes in 2003, Johnny passes just a few months later, because of the loss of June, he had lost his reason to live. But in 1956, Johnny Cash was not married to June Carter Cash. She was simply June Carter then. He was married to Vivian, and that marriage ended in 1966, in large part because Johnny Cash had an utter inability to walk the line. He couldn't do it. That marriage ends in 1966 because of a history of infidelity on the part of Johnny, drug use on the part of Johnny, his interesting relationship with June Carter on the part of Johnny, and the effects that touring had on the part of Johnny. Johnny's inability to walk the line is what cratered the marriage he is writing about in this song. So there's this weird duality going on here. On the one side is this nice, pretty, optimistic love song about a young man on the road trying to be true. And I have the advantage of when I was 24, I was a young man and I was on the road a ton. And so I know what it is to be a young man on the road trying to make a marriage work. But Johnny Cash did not do it. He didn't walk the line. Not even a little bit. Eventually, Johnny grows up, and eventually he understands his own brokenness, and eventually, honestly, he uses his understanding of his own brokenness to reach people for Jesus, which is awesome. And him and June Carter Cash have a wonderful lifetime partnership, but unfortunately, it took the failed marriage with Vivian to help him to get there. This song is aspirational, to say the least, and in some ways is an outright lie on the part of Johnny. Johnny Cash, at this stage of his life, did not walk the line. It doesn't change the fact that the song is beautiful. It doesn't change the fact that the song is how we should all treat our spouses. We should all resist temptation because when we are in that kind of relationship. It's just that Johnny didn't. And that leads to also a really interesting connection with the book of Jonah and the character of Jonah the prophet. Because in a real way, Jonah also does not walk the line even a little bit, and also writes a lovely song that turns out to be largely untrue on behalf of Jonah the prophet. You see, a prophet's fundamental job is to be the mouthpiece of God. A prophet gets a word from God, as then is supposed to go relay that word to God from God, whatever that word is, to whoever God has told that prophet to do it. So if the prophet has a word of hope for the people of Israel, the prophet stands up and says, "Thus says the Lord." Good news, it's all going to work out great. They don't get a lot of those messages, but sometimes they happen. And sometimes a prophet is given a vision of the future from God. And a prophet stands up and says, "Thus says the Lord, this is what's going to happen. You're going into exile." That part happens a lot. Or then sometimes the prophet has words of condemnation. "Thus says the Lord, y'all are really messing up. You're going to get blasted." That's a prophet's job. And Jonah, book of Jonah opens with the fact that Jonah is a prophet. In fact, Jonah is a prophet that is mentioned in the book of Kings. Jonah is most definitely a prophet. And at the opening of the book of Jonah, Jonah is given a word from the Lord to deliver. Jonah is to deliver a word of condemnation to the city of Nineveh, the capital of the Neo-Assyrian Empire, a big important city in the ancient world. And Jonah is supposed to go there and say, you people of Nineveh, you're going to get blasted. Tough luck. You messed up. And what does Jonah do? Jonah the prophet, whose purpose is to relay God's word. What does Jonah do? He runs in the exact opposite direction, gets on a ship, and sails away. As far as he can get from Nineveh, out into the sea, off Jonah goes. And then he gets caught up in a storm, because you can't actually run from God, right? That's a really bad idea. And then the sailors on the boat go, hey, why is it raining? What did you do, kid? And he goes, hey, just throw me into the sea. So in Jonah goes to the sea, and this is how Jonah ends up in the belly of a fish. God rescues Jonah from drowning by having him be eaten by a giant fish. Yes, was it probably a whale? Yeah, probably. Does that really matter? No, it does not. Some sort of large sea creature eats Jonah, and now Jonah is in the belly of the fish, essentially put in time out by God to really think about what he has done. Think about his life and think about his choices and maybe make some better choices, because Jonah had failed at choice making up until this point. And so our verses today, all of chapter 2 of Jonah, picks Jonah up inside the belly of the fish. He has been rescued from death, but is now stuck in a fish, which happens to be sailing back to Nineveh, and he has to wrestle with who he is supposed to be and what God wants him to do. And this is where he sings this psalm. It is written as a psalm, not as a speech, and so he reads or says aloud, cries out to God with this psalm, and on the surface, it starts to sound like maybe some things are beginning to click in Jonah's mind that had not previously. Here again, verses 7 through 10. As my life was ebbing away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you in your holy temple. Those who worship vain idols forsake their true loyalty, but I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will pay. Deliverance belongs to the Lord. Then the Lord spoke to the fish, and it spewed Jonah out on the dry land. On the surface? Okay. Sounds like Jonah got it, right? I vow, I'm going to do it. What I vow to do, I will do. I've gotten deliverance from you. Those who worship vain idols, they are not loyal. But I, Jonah, I am loyal. I, Jonah, have got it together. Great. Here's the thing, though. That psalm that Jonah says doesn't quite fit. It is actually wildly out of place in a lot of ways. The psalm itself talks about how Jonah has been delivered from the dead, from the land of the dead, which isn't quite what happened. He got eaten by a fish. It is a psalm of thanksgiving, saying thank you for deliverance, even though he's still inside the fish. The words don't quite match the situation, and it's almost like Jonah is singing a song he already knew that someone else wrote, and it's the only thing that occurs to him while he's in the belly of this fish. Think like you're having a really hard spiritual time, and the only thing you can think of are the words to Amazing Grace, and so you just sing that. I think that's what's happening here. Jonah is being reminded of a song he knew that someone else wrote, and it fit close enough, and so he says that because he can't come up with other words to say. It's what I would do with Jesus Freak, right? Pick whatever your favorite hymn is that comes to you in your worst moment. That's, I think, what Jonah is doing. It's a little out of place, but there is this underlying, like, thanksgiving that God has rescued him from drowning, I guess, and a commitment to be loyal. And a judgment on those who are not loyal. Those who worship vain idols, they're not loyal. But I, Jonah, I vow, I'm loyal now. I've got it together. And again, on the surface, it seems like, okay, he goes and does it, right? Gets spewed. So spewed is not quite a strong enough a word. The Hebrew word there is more like puked. Like, think of a disgust, kind of disgusting word for vomiting. That's the word. It's like a gross word. So we'll go with puked, because this is a family show. But, like, you know, think of whatever gross word you've yacked up, right? You know, this is whatever happened to Jonah, it's gross. That's why I like this painting of, like, all of these fish. Like, it just looks kind of gross, while still being publicly acceptable. So he gets gross puked onto the beach of Nineveh, and he goes and does what God asked him to do. He walks around Nineveh and goes, 40 days and you're going to get destroyed. You're going to get destroyed. You're dead. Tough luck. You messed up. Well, his words are very effective. They strike the king of Nineveh and the people of Nineveh to their core, and they get really into the idea of repentance. They even make their animals repent, and they repent, and they wear sackcloth, and they fast, and they go bananas to please God. And because we know the character of God pretty well, lo and behold, God relents. As sometimes happens when God issues an oracle of doom through a prophet, there is, even if it is stated as, this is going to happen, there's always that opportunity for God to be merciful anyways. And God is merciful anyways. They come to God, and God relents. Great! That should be every prophet's dream. It is certainly every pastor's dream that you speak a word from the Lord, and then everyone repents and gets really into repenting and goes bananas for repentance and even makes their dogs repent. Right? Like, it worked. Is Jonah happy about this? No, thank you, Gene. Yeah, no. Jonah is way less than pleased. Here, Jonah chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. Spoilers for the end of the book of Jonah. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "Oh, Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful and slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." You gotta love Jonah. He's great. So this whole song about being loyal and how he's so much better now than all of the other people who worship vain idols, and that he would keep his vow, that is, seek after God's purpose for his life, turned out to be, just like Johnny Cash and I Walk the Line, aspirational at best. Because here he has done what God needed him to do, and he's unhappy because God's purpose was played out and not Jonah's purpose. Jonah wanted to just declare a word and be right and for Nineveh to get zapped. And God was merciful. And Jonah is angry that God did what God wanted to do and God didn't do what Jonah wanted to do. Jonah lost sight of the fact that he's there to serve God as God's prophet. And instead wants God to do what Jonah wants God to do. And God doesn't do that. And so Jonah has this song, chapter 2, verses 1 through 10, that this is this pledge, this vow of loyalty that I am here and you have delivered me from the depths of Sheol and I will be loyal and see I make my vow. And then immediately he doesn't do it. He begrudgingly follows God's instructions. And then when it doesn't work out the way he wants, Jonah yells at God for doing God's will and not Jonah's will. Again, like Johnny Cash, it is aspirational more than it is reality. That both Johnny Cash and Jonah are incredibly imperfect servants of God. Are they imperfect? Yes, they are absolutely imperfect. Johnny Cash writes this song about how he definitely walks the line and serves the tie that binds and goes to bed every night alone and then absolutely does none of those things. Jonah makes this grand pledge of loyalty to God so that he will get ugly vomited out of a fish, and it then doesn't do it. Does the bare minimum and then shakes his tiny fist of rage at God for not doing Jonah's will. So both of them make for imperfect servants of God. And on some level, there's hope in that, because both of them also get used by God for God's purpose, even if they are more than kind of a mess. You know, Johnny Cash goes on to be a kind of evangelist and a Bible scholar, and even got like a degree in biblical studies so that he could better talk to people about Jesus. He ends up figuring out how to walk the line and ends up really serving God in doing so. And through Jonah's work, begrudging and imperfect as it is, Nineveh is still saved. Nineveh still repents because Jonah served as the mouthpiece of God in that moment. Even if he hated what he had to say, even if he did it begrudgingly, even if he himself doesn't follow his own words, his words made a difference. And so for all of us who find ourselves as imperfect servants of God, there's some hope in these guys. That they all had their issues, and both of them, pretty major issues as issues go. And yet God used them as occasionally even unwilling servants. And so for each of us, in our own imperfections, you are at least in really good company of Johnny Cash and the biblical prophet Jonah as imperfect people who can still make a difference in God's world. But the core message of the book of Jonah, to me, is to remember whose will we serve. That it is not our own will, it is God's will. It is not our own will that we are in this world to do. It is God's will that we are in this world to do. And it is sometimes okay to shake your tiny rage fist at God as long as you keep sight of whose will we are here to serve. Right? Because there's another servant of God who gets upset at what God asked him to do. But it goes way different, right? Jesus, in the Garden of Gethsemane, prays to God, Lord, I don't want to do this. This is rough. This sounds painful. You know how they're going to kill me? It sounds terrible. But at the end of that prayer, he says, this quote, right? Not my will, but God, but your will be done. And then he goes. He doesn't begrudgingly do it. He goes and he does it. He commits and actually seeks after God's will and God's will alone. And that's part of what makes Christ perfect. That Christ had a moment of crisis just means that he, like the rest of us, is human. But what makes Christ God among us and perfect is that then once he is reminded, remember whose will you are here to serve, he goes and willingly does it, that it is a willing sacrifice, not a begrudging one. What Jonah gets wrong is he forgets whose will he is there to do. And any time we seek to hold on to our own self-determination and try and run from what God has for us, we miss the point too. Look, we all like the idea that we get to do whatever we want. Most of us in this room are grown-ups, and that means I can do whatever I want, right? Nope. But this isn't just like you also still have to pay taxes and pay your bills and you got to live somewhere. This is also more to the core of how we are to live. The core of why we have the gifts we have. The core to why we have life and breath and abilities and money and a house and a job and all this. Why we have what we have. Why God has given us what we have is so that we may serve God's purpose in the world even when we don't like what that purpose is. Sometimes God will tell you to do things you do not want to do. And we have to remember that fundamentally, we serve the creator of the universe. And we have what we have so that we will be servants of God. And even Christ, God among us, sets that example for us that our lives are about God's will and not our will. And so finally, friends, the real challenge here is to aspire to walk the line. That if both Jonah's song and Johnny Cash's song are aspirational, neither of these two men live up to their song, at least immediately, we may not live up to God's purpose for us immediately either. But the point is still to aspire to walk the line. and walk the line, meaning serving God's purpose in our lives and God's purpose in the world and seeking after God's will in our life and God's will alone. That's the line we are called to walk. And when we walk that line, we are a part of building a more beautiful world. And when we walk that line, we are building a more beautiful life for ourselves. When we walk that line, we are building the kingdom of God. And so, friends, may we all walk the line. Let us pray. Gracious, loving God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks that you do not give up on us. We give you thanks that just like Johnny Cash and just like Jonah, that you can see through our mistakes, see through the places we fall short, see through the times when we don't live up to our own wonderful songs, and don't give up on us. Loving God, give us the strength then to walk the line, to seek you, to seek your purpose, to build your kingdom. In Jesus' most holy name we pray, amen. I know I stretched it a little bit when I called this Summer of Rock, but this song in particular is specifically for David. David is more of the country musician surrounded by a whole bunch of rock and rollers and the punk rocker.
I
picked this for David, and then David was out for a while, and then David came back just in time for us to do Johnny Cash's Walk the Line. And so I give you a country song in the middle of Summer of Rock in honor of our country music singer who can actually do this. I give you Johnny Cash's Walk the Line.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line. I find it very, very easy to be true. I find myself alone when each day's through. Yes, I'll admit that I'm a fool for you. Because you're mine, I walk the line. As sure as night is dark and day is light, I keep you on my mind both day and night. And happiness I know proves that it's right. Because you're mine, I walk the line. You've got a way on your side. You give me cause for love that I can't hide. For you I know I'd even try to turn the tide. Because you're mine, I walk the line. I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
I don't know if y'all know how deep that actually is. That's pretty deep.